different macroeconomic variables and the indicators can be changed in order to influence the direction and duration of the growth of the countries, of the economies. And in that sense, this meeting to me and to UNEP is very dear, very important. So on behalf of UNEP, we welcome you all. I wanted to highlight three things in the very beginning of the meeting. Number one, that whatever we have seen since last 2008, I'm talking about economic crisis at the global level. In that context and otherwise, the macroeconomic factors and instruments, they have a very strong role to play. Today, our planet is facing triple challenges. I mean, three challenges basically. One is economic instability, second, the environmental crisis, and third, inadequate equity in the social system. And in each of the problem, macroeconomic instruments, including some of the indicators, for example, right GDP, has a strong role to play. Second, we have seen that macroeconomic policies and those related to international debt, finance, and management, they have the potential to provide and create enabling conditions for growth. And the history of global financial and economic crisis, and after that, they have shown that although they have the potential, but sometimes they, due to inefficiency or indolence on part of various actors, the economy does not move in the right direction. The same dynamics that inflated the dollar value of GDP in good years now continues to say something in different direction after the crisis. The other aspect which I would like to mention, the economic growth is increasingly being compromised by the continued reduction of natural capital. It might look a bit of unseemingly or unrelated issues, but they are related in the sense that the way economic growth is being extracted and nurtured and seen by the policymakers, they are not having good impact on the condition resilience of natural capital. Unfortunately, our present measures of progress need to be reevaluated. Current indicators such as GDP are insufficient to provide robust feedbacks on the societal progress or regress made by nations. GDP largely fail, for instance, to reflect the state of natural resources and focus exclusively on the short term without indicating whether national policies are going to last for long. We also know that there exist many reasons to invest in natural capital. Let me tell you some, but some of the obvious examples where natural capital has a big contribution to make through supporting a wide range of economic agents and sectors, maintaining options for economic growth, cost-effective response policies for environmental goods, creating jobs, and also providing sustenance and resilience in maintaining diversity of growth across sectors, scale, and time. Now, but that is not happening. That is not happening. That exists in theory. Because sustainable development has become a kind of, as somebody has rightly said, it's just like getting down to heaven, but nobody wants to go down there so soon. Many world leaders are increasingly sounding the alarm about the significant impact of human activities which is creating on natural capital. For example, the landmark assessment report by Millennium Ecosystem in 2005, they have shown that many of the natural capitals are on decline or are being compromised in the process of achieving growth. Now, why this is happening? This is happening then many of reasons. One of them is certainly failures of decision-making process and the actors. Although the world is rich in solutions, they have a range of solutions, the world actors, most of the local successes and stories towards sustainability are often trapped at that level. And one has to question, why do such success stories remain in the reports and why can't we replicate them? One part of the answer might rest in the barriers keeping in information not conveyed to policymakers for action. And not only that, there is also a problem that we probably are not embracing the adaptive learning, not learning to our kind of blindness. As Daniel Kahneman used to say, or he still says, that we can't be only blind to obvious, but many times we are blind to our blindness too. And continuing with the current GDP, the way they are, and knowing that they are not reflecting the true progress and welfare, has been in the profession of economics for the last 3 to 4 decades at least, but still we are continuing. And in that sense, at this juncture, talking about beyond GDP in the region of Asia Pacific, where the entire financial axis of the world has moved in, has a great relevance. I would also like to mention here that natural scientists, economists, and policymakers have very good ideas to address the role and problems in managing natural capital. However, various cognitive biases and barriers have prevented wise policies from being implemented. In fact, in that sense, doing this meeting here in Bangkok, where not only the UN agencies have come together, like UNSCAP, UNDP, the World Bank, but the scientific network like SANDI or IPSI, they are playing a good role. And you have seen my compliments to Priya, who has brought all these agencies, UNSD in a big way. Of course, UNSD has a specific role to play here. They can guide us on how some of the robust methodological framework we can use, and so that we can reach where we want to reach. So I think I would stop with this and welcome you all once again. I hope by the end of day 3, we will have a concrete action plan, follow-up action, if not declaration from this meeting, where the countries can think of going in the direction emerging from this meeting here in Bangkok. I will stop here, welcome you all on behalf of UNEP once again, and I will pass the mic to my colleague.